15 years later, the cinema is taking its first steps. Cameramen employed by the Lumiere brothers filming at Jerusalem station provide the first moving pictures taken in Palestine. From now on, the camera is a recording eye, and what it records is this: a society much like that of Cairo, Damascus, or Beirut, in an Arab city much like any other. By the end of the 19th century, Palestine has 500,000 inhabitants, of whom 30,000 live in Jerusalem. A veiled woman, a Sunni Muslim, one of the majority. An Orthodox Jew. He too turns away from the camera. Here we have an Armenian Pope. Each of the Christian denominations has its church here in the Holy City. The holy places of the three religions are scattered across a few hundred square meters. The great mosque is close to Christ's tomb. Further along, at the foot of the Wailing Wall, a Jew is reciting a prayer. He is wearing a Turkish tabouche, and though he prays in Hebrew, his everyday language is Arabic. Jews form half the population of Jerusalem, but in the country as a whole, they make up less than 5% of the total. Christians account for 10% and Muslims 85%. All of them are subjects of the Sultan of Constantinople. There are no frontiers in the Ottoman Empire. There are administrative divisions in which, in this immense territory, Palestine occupies a mere 27,000 square kilometers, made up of three small districts in the south of the province of Damascus. The same empire in the 17th century. In the meantime, it has lost the Balkans, France and Italy have seized North Africa. England has moved into Egypt, Aden, and even Kuwait.
While in power in Afghanistan, the Taliban became notorious internationally for their discrimination against women. Afghan women were forced to wear the burqa at all times. Women and girls were systematically discriminated against and marginalized. Their human rights utterly violated. But that was not always the case with Afghan women. From the 19th century and through the 20th century, the rulers of Afghanistan consistently attempted to lessen women's restrictions in the country. Among them was King Amanullah, who ruled from 1919 to 1929 and made some of the more noteworthy changes in an attempt to modernize the country. King Amanullah promoted freedom for women in the public sphere in order to lessen the control that patriarchal families had over women. He stressed the importance for young girls and women to receive an education. Students from elementary and middle schools emulated their counterparts in the European countries, learning about nature trails, camping and public safety. Along with encouraging families to send their daughters to school, he promoted the unveiling of women and persuaded them to adopt a more Western style of dress. In 1921, he created a law that abolished forced marriage, child marriage, bride price, and put restrictions on polygamy, a common practice among households in Afghanistan. Modern social reform for Afghan women began when Queen Soraya made rapid reforms to improve women's lives and their position in the family. In 1946, Queen Humaira created the Women's Society, which was the first ever women's institute in Afghanistan. In 1959, she supported the call by the Prime Minister Mohammad Daoud Khan for women to voluntarily remove the veil by removing her own. One particularly interesting segment in the history of Afghan women is during the 1960s. The government oversaw various rural development programs where female nurses were sent in jeeps to remote areas and villages to inoculate residents from diseases such as cholera. In 1964, women helped to draft Afghanistan's third constitution, which gave women the right to vote and opened the doors of elected office to women. Throughout most of the 1960s and 1970s, women saw increased participation in politics. Rukia Habib Abubakar, Massima Ismati Wardak and Dr. Anahita Rattizad were elected as members of parliament subsequent to adoption of the third constitution, while Humaira Melchior Salajiki and Aziza Gardishi were appointed as senators. It was not unusual for men and women to casually mingle at movie theaters and on university campuses. On coming to power in April 1978, the PDPA government began to implement serious reforms favoring women, such as eliminating the bride price, educating women and freeing them from the burqa. During this time it made significant advances towards modernization. More women were able to hold jobs as scientists, teachers, doctors, and civil servants and had a considerable amount of freedom with significant educational opportunities. They formed child care centers in their workplaces to make it easier for women to work. Maternity leave was extended to 3 months from 6 weeks and they were still getting their salary. The Afghan government also began mass literacy campaigns and provided free medical care. They banned bride price and forced marriage among others, and the minimum age for marriage was raised among other advances in both matrimonial and women's rights. They also stressed the importance of education in Afghanistan. The government stressed education for both women and men. They also set up literacy programs in the country. During communist rule, the PDPA government reformed the education system. Education was stressed for both sexes, and widespread literacy programs were set up. By 1988, women made up 40% of the doctors and 60% of the teachers at Kabul University. 440,000 female students were enrolled in different educational institutions and 80,000 more in literacy programs. The majority of women, however, lived in poverty and were excluded from these opportunities. In 1977, the Revolutionary Association of the Women of Afghanistan, RAWA, was founded by Mina Kishore Kamal in Kabul, which launched a bilingual magazine titled Woman's Message, Payam Ezan, in 1981 and organized events in the city of Kabul for several years to mark International Women's Day. By the late 1980s, women made up 40% of the country's doctors. Women doctors were in high demand, especially in rural areas, where women were still strictly secluded and barred from consulting male doctors. "60% of the instructors at Kabul University and 65% of the student body were women. Family courts, in some cases presided over by female judges, had replaced the Mullah Sharia courts. The number of working women increased 50-fold. By 1987, there were an estimated 245,000 women working in fields ranging from construction, printing and food processing to radio and TV journalism and especially teaching, where they made up 70% of the workforce.
U.S. National Security Advisor Brzezinski flew to Pakistan to set about rallying resistance. He wanted to arm the Mujahideen without revealing America's role. On the Afghan border near the Khyber Pass, he urged the soldiers of God to redouble their efforts.
We know of their deep belief in God, and we are confident that their struggle will succeed. That land over there is yours. You'll go back to it one day because your fight will prevail, and you'll have your homes and your mosques back again because your cause is right and God is on your side.
The purpose of coordinating with the Pakistanis would be to make the Soviets bleed for as much and as long.
Inside the bright tented enclosure, 1,500 men waited. We were told that many of these men were Mujahideen who traveled from the border specially for this meeting. A mullah chanted some verses from the Quran concerning exiles. Mrs. Thatcher promised them an extra £2 million worth of aid, and she made clear the West's support for the Afghan resistance fighters.
I want to say that the hearts of the free world are with you, and with those of your countrymen who have stayed.
And that gained her ringing shouts of support.
On from the US-led invasion that forced them from power in Afghanistan, the Taliban don't look like they're going anywhere anytime soon. Not only have they proved themselves to be a formidable fighting force, but even the United States has said that future peace can only be achieved if the Afghan government negotiates with the hardline Islamic movement. But who actually are the Taliban? This is what one viewer asked us earlier this week in the comments section of the Monday show. And so we thought we'd try and give him, and all the rest of you who might be wondering the same thing, an answer. Let's go back to the beginning. The Taliban is a mainly Pashtun movement that emerged in northern Pakistan in the early 1990s, a few years after the withdrawal of occupying Soviet forces from neighbouring Afghanistan in 1988. The Pashtun people are an ethnic group, primarily living in southern Afghanistan and northwestern Pakistan. However, while the majority of the Taliban's fighters are of Pashtun ethnicity, the Afghan journalist Abad Daya says it would be wrong to call the Taliban a Pashtun nationalist movement, and that most Afghans see the movement as influenced by a certain strand of religious teaching rather than nationality or ethnicity.